Hello everyone, welcome to the Learn Biology Online, and today we are going to discuss about the mode of enzyme action or how these enzymes used to bind with the substrate and how the product will form. So the mechanism that we are going to study today. First, there is a hypothesis which is given by the Emil Fischer in 1894 is a lock and key hypothesis. Now, according to this hypothesis, every lock has a specific key. You cannot open every lock with every key, no, or any lock with every key, no. There is a particular lock, and for a particular lock, there has a specific key. So likewise, the enzyme have a particular active site, and this particular active site is having an amino acid which basically shows a complementarity with a particular substrate or a specific substrate. Here you can see this is an enzyme and this is a substrate, and this is enzyme having a particular active site. Okay, now this particular active site will bind to this specific substrate and they'll come together and they form a ES complex. That is, they come together and form a ES complex. Now we know that the enzyme having a catalytic group. That catalytic group has the power to catalyze a reaction by breaking the bond of substrate molecule and form the product. So here you can see the product will form, and this enzyme will remain same. This is not utilized in the reaction. This can also be used for next round. So this is how this lock and key function. Okay. Just read it. Both enzyme and substrate have a specific geometrical shape, and the active site contain a special group, you know, which is either be amino acid or particular specific, you know, thiol group. So having a special group for establishing a contact with a substrate molecule, just as a lock can be opened by its specific key. So this basically explains the specificity of enzyme action. So this shows that how these enzymes are very specific or very particular about their actions. Move to the next hypothesis or theory, that is an induced fit theory. Okay, here you can understand that if you are in the winter, if you are buying a gloves for your hand, then you just buy them in a generalized way. Okay, and when you wore them, you'll find that whether it is a small or a little bit big, it basically fits into your hand. Why? Because gloves are flexible, you know, they can flexible, so they can easily fit into our hand. So likewise, the enzyme have active site which is flexible, and this theory is given by Koshland in 1959. According to this theory, the active site has two groups. First is a catalytic group and second is a buttressing group. Now this catalytic group is basically required for catalyzing the reaction to breaking the bond of substrate molecule and forms the product. While the buttressing group has a function which is meant for only supporting the substrate. They are basically meant for supporting the substrate. So here you can see this is an active site. Okay, so this is a buttressing group. This whole is a buttressing group, and this is a catalytic group. This is A, B, C, D, E, F, G. Now substrate, this is a substrate. As you can see here, there is no way that this substrate will bind to this active site. No, but because this buttressing group is flexible and then easily allow any substrate to bind, by changing their position, by changing some bonds, they'll fit this substrate. You know, the substrate is fit into this reaction, and also they bring the catalytic group. This is the catalytic group. It brings that catalytic group opposite the substrate bonds to be broken. You know, this bond need to be broken. So the buttressing group is responsible for bringing this catalytic group, which is opposite the substrate bonds, to be broken. So this is how this induced model will work. Now study. So when the substrate comes in contact with this buttressing group, the active site changes to bring the catalytic site or group opposes the substrate bonds to be broken to give rise a product. This is how these two mechanism work. Now move to the next topic. I told you in the previous class there are the cofactors and the coenzyme will bind with an apoenzyme. Apoenzymes are the proteinaceous type of enzyme, while the cofactors are inorganic molecules and the coenzymes are the inorganic molecules. So they'll combine together for more efficient for increasing the efficiency of an enzyme. Here you can see these are the coenzymes, the organic molecules. Now the B1, you know, the vitamin B1 give rise to this thymine pyrophosphate, also we call them TPP, and this TPP is required for aldehyde group transfer. Okay, now vitamin B2, that is riboflavin, having a coenzyme that is FAD and FMN. Okay, this will responsible for the redox reaction. Redox means for both oxidation and the reduction. As you know, the FAD will convert into the FADH2, and this FADH2 will again convert into FAD positive. Now vitamin B6, which having a coenzyme pyridoxal phosphate, and this is required for amino group transfer. Next is nicotinic acid or niacin, that has a special group that is NAD positive and NAD positive. This is very important. As you know, in every chemical reaction these are required. Now they are also responsible for redox reaction. So NAD will convert into NADH, and this NADH again convert into NAD positive. Next important thing is this vitamin B5, that is pantothenic acid, is having a coenzyme A, and this coenzyme A is required for acyl group transfer. Okay, next remember this is also important. Biotin having a coenzyme that is biocytin, and this biocytin is required for a carboxylation process, means for transferring a carbon dioxide, you know, CO2 ko transfer karne ke liye hota hai. Now there is a folic acid which is having a coenzyme that is tetrahydrofolate, which is THF. This is a THF that is required for one carbon transfer. You know, one carbon group transfer is done by this tetrahydrofolic acid. Now, this is not so important. Vitamin B12 is having a coenzyme that is deoxyadenosylcobalamin, and this is required for intramolecular rearrangements. Move to these cofactors. You know that this is Fe2 positive and this is Fe3 positive, which is required in cytochrome oxidase and catalases, peroxidases. Now this calcium is required in thrombin and thrombokinases. These are the clotting factors which require a calcium ion for activation. Okay. Now this magnesium ion is required mostly in the glycolysis process. So the enzyme like hexokinase, pyruvate kinase, enolase, phosphotransferase, so they basically contain a magnesium ion as a cofactor. Copper ion in cytochrome oxidase. Now this is not important. Molybdenum is required in a nitrate reductase. When we are doing a nitrogen fixation in the plants, then this molybdenum is required during a nitrate reductase. Now this Mn2 positive is required in ribonucleotide reductase, RNR. So this is required there, and in the arginase also. Arginase is required in the urea cycle. Okay. Now this zinc is required in alcohol dehydrogenase. As we know, when the ethanol we formed by using acetyl coenzyme A after the pyruvate, you know, when after the glycolysis pyruvate will form. Now this pyruvate enter into the anaerobic pathway and they form ethanol. So zinc ion is required during this method, and this LDH. Yeah, this is enough. And this silicon is required in a thiolase. sorry, selenium. Now this K positive is required in pyruvate kinase, as you know that I already discussed the pyruvate kinase with you in the glycolysis. Now nickel is utilized in the ureasis enzyme. This is important. Chloride ion in salivary amylase. This is also important. And sodium is required in ATPase. So this is about the mechanism, cofactors and coenzyme. And in the next class, we will discuss more topics about enzyme. So I hope you will understand what I teach you today. Thank you so much for watching this video. Thank you.